I think for teens, probably I think the most important thing to realize is that when kids get to that age, they're voting with their feet. And so if the program isn't fun, if the young people aren't engaged in actually making decisions about the substance of the activities and what they're actually going to be involved in, those programs don't typically retain attendance all that well. I think that in general, there are two basic approaches for effective out-of-school time programs. One is how they approach learning, and their approach to learning, I think I would put in one general category. Programs that are very proactive, that recognize where kids are in terms of their own learning performance and their achievement, and move those kids forward, and focus on acceleration of learning, a very proactive model. I think a lot has to do with how they approach learning in that space. It's fun, it's informal, it's engaging. And then the other piece of it that I think is really critical for programs to focus on are all the infrastructure components that are really essential for out-of-school time programs to be successful. Things like staffing, things like sustainable funding, making sure that there's strong leadership in place in those programs. And so you have to both have your approach to learning right and all of those infrastructure components to really have a successful program. I think what summer programs provide is something different and something unique from what young people might typically experience during the school year. And so the break from the norm and from what may be causing some of the issues and challenges or struggles for adolescents might be something that would be really beneficial. So the idea is that summer programs can give kids a different opportunity, a different experience, perhaps an opportunity to explore something that they're interested in, that they can have an opportunity to be successful and maybe a more hands-on, a more active learning experience than they might get during the regular school year. I think a great example would be a program here in Washington, D.C. called Higher Achievement that takes young people who might have an interest in science and really engages them over the summer in some hands-on exploration where they're doing science experiments and they have access to labs and to materials that they wouldn't have access to during the regular school year. And so that's, I think, a very concrete example of a way in which a program can engage kids in this way. So I think the best way to make remediation and to make intensive academic support palatable for kids is to really help them understand that this is a valuable time and it is a time that they can go back and relearn or have additional one-on-one time with teachers or with tutors during the summer months, and to get them bought into the notion that they can catch up, that this is possible, that if we work really hard over the next 4 to 6 weeks, we can close some of these gaps and we can make sure that when you go back to school in the fall, that you'll be closer, in terms of where you need to be and in terms of academic performance. So I think the big piece of all of this is to help kids kind of really envision and realize, what the end of all of this is and what the real goal of all of these learning activities are. So it's not just about line them up in rows and make sure we drill and practice on all of this academic content. It's really helping them understand that I want to go to college, I want to be successful in a career and in life, and this is a necessary tool or a time of year when I can get ahead and I can have access to these kinds of learning opportunities. Well, high-quality summer learning programs use a variety of assessments and a variety of different outcomes to measure their impact and their success. Many programs use a pre- and post-summer assessment where they look at either literacy or math skills, and research has shown consistently that kids who participate in a full-day comprehensive summer enrichment program that blends the kind of academic support and remediation that we talked about earlier with additional enrichment experiences, those kids benefit significantly on standardized test scores. I think in a lot of times we sort of get the means and the ends confused, and I think in a lot of cases what we're trying to advocate is that summer programs that that have that balanced approach, that comprehensive approach, can really have a stronger impact on standardized test scores than, in some cases, a lot of programs that try to do simply test preparation over the summer months. I think there are other important outcomes to keep in mind as well, in addition to standardized test performance. I mean, the summer programs that we know that have been very successful have had an impact on first quarter attendance rates for ninth graders and 10th graders in high school. So if they're excited and interested in learning and they're connected to teachers and to staff during the summer who really care about them and take time to really personalize and individualize learning and instruction for them, they're more likely to attend school at better rates in the fall. And so outcomes like that, I think, are as significant and as important as some of the other ones we talked about. Well, when we talk to adolescents about what challenges they face over the summer, we consistently hear a message that young people want to participate in summer programs, but there simply aren't enough out there. They want to take part in a summer program that will help prepare them to go back to school in the fall, ready to learn and ready to succeed. I think for young people in disadvantaged communities, one particular challenge is that there aren't enough programs that are tied specifically to their interests and to their skills. And for many of them, those camps, those specialty camps that are focused on a particular instrument or a particular skill that the kids might have, cost a lot of money. And those programs tend to be more available to kids who are in middle and upper income families. I think what the research says very strongly and very convincingly is that young people need to be engaged in learning year-round, regardless of what particular setting they're in, whether that's a school setting or a community-based organization or at home. I think rather than fighting a battle over when the school year starts and ends, we should really be working together to make sure that more parents and more kids and more families have access to choices during the summer months. And so when we look out in the field and see what opportunities actually exist for kids, there are opportunities in community-based organizations and libraries and camps and other kinds of experiences for kids. And we think perhaps a better strategy than to say to extend the school year and to add days to the calendar would be to really make sure that parents who don't have access right now to take advantage of those opportunities take advantage of them. So our vision would be that lower income families, kids who live in high poverty communities, have the same access to choices and to opportunities that middle and upper income families provide for their kids. And it strikes me that schools are an important part of that. There could be really, and there are very good models of school-linked or school-based programs, but they're certainly not the only partner that needs to be involved in that.
Funding for AdLit.org is provided by the Ann B. and Thomas L. Friedman Family Foundation. For more information on adolescent literacy, please visit us online at www.adlit.org.